A while back, we took a look at some music by Yoko Kanno, some of the big band stuff from Cowboy Bebop. This reminds me a lot of that. Part of it almost felt like James Bond. So just based on the album cover too, it might be something in the same kind of line. I mean, there's the crosshairs and the gun. So I mean, I don't know if it's a spy-related type of thing. And being from the late 70s, I mean, this style is exactly what you would have expected to hear in that time. It's jazz influenced, but it's not really jazz. It's more like a mixture of jazz and pop rhythms from that particular time, but the big band sounds, they're great. Whoa! There's some interesting harmony going on. I could sit here and I could take apart exactly what chord changes there were, because if you listen to that motion, it sounded like a chordal instrument, maybe an electric piano of some kind, and the bass, of course. That motion, I would consider that to be more of like a passing motion where it doesn't matter so much what it is exactly. In fact, if I hadn't pointed it out, some people might not have picked up on it. That's kind of because it's really meant to just kind of drive your ear from one place to the next, but it adds an interesting color while doing so. So you don't actually have to have that there and it'll still accomplish the same thing. It's just kind of an extra little bit of color that we can put into the movement. Now, none of those chords, whatever they might be, we're not sitting on any of them for any particular period of time. If we don't sit here and take apart exactly what they are, it's not going to fundamentally change where the music is going. Your ear's going to still follow the same trajectory. That's kind of what passing chords and oftentimes passing tones do as well. They can be notes or chords that are outside of what you would typically expect within the key center, but they're really only serving as like a quick passing over to get us from point A to point B. And that's what's going on there. This is so 70s, it's great. Sounds really good. Really solid. Probably not like my favorite thing I've ever heard in this sort of, you know, in this space, but really, I mean, band sounds good, composition sounds good, the solo sounded great. Really nice. Kids on the Slope. So already I'm hearing the influences of like McCoy Tyner and the Coltrane version of My Favorite Things. Voicings that are created with stacked fourths. You can do a lot with this, and it's something that we play in jazz like all the time. I mean, these moving fourths, they're literally just perfect fourth, perfect fourth, perfect fourth, perfect fourth. And we just stack fourths on top of each other, and then you can move that all over the place. And in fact, even just one alteration away, which is instead of leaving the fourth on the top, if we turn that into a third, this is that so what chord. That's the chord. And that has become like a staple voicing that we use in jazz all the time. I mean, it's... It's just such a beautiful sound, and it has some suspense sort of built into it a little bit, and it's very wide open. It leaves a lot of room for you to develop ideas. It's not that defined. You know, you could kind of place that voicing over a number of different root positions. It's gonna work in various ways. So this type of McCoy Tyner influence, I'm already hearing it in, like, immediately, and it sounds great. Oh, really? Wow, that was a transition, okay. Yeah. All right, so we've moved from My Favorite Things to... Someday my prince will come. This is nice. Really? Okay. Moaning. It's fun tune. This is interesting. What a bizarre combination of tunes to just like combine like this. These individuals are playing very well. So this is playing off of that style, the sing, sing, sing style. Early big band, Benny Goodman. Maybe nowadays seen as a little bit like corny, old school, kind of cheesy, corny type of thing. It all depends on application. Sometimes you want Count Basie and Duke Ellington and really sophisticated, developed big band. And sometimes you want a much more jam sounding type of old school sound like this. I don't know what the application is. I don't know about the show, but yeah, it's based on that early sort of big band kind of style. So those are sections where like it'll be written into the chart. Probably not everybody, but certain people from each section. I mean, you know, you'll get a just blow over this section for a few bars, and it kind of just sounds like chaos because everybody's improvising together and playing crazy stuff. That's by design. I mean, it's supposed to sound chaotic, and it's supposed to sound like, oh, a bunch of crazy stuff all happening at once. Yeah, no, it's a cool sound. One at a time, we're adding instruments in. We started with the Barry, probably, again, this is all probably notated in the chart. The Barry starts improvising, and then the trumpet joins in. I think I heard some clarinet in there as well. We just keep adding people, and it just builds and builds and builds this chaotic thing. And so instead of using maybe compositional development, we're using improvisation, collective improvisation within a large group. And it's not just like mindlessly, blindly playing, but also trying to hear what's going on around you. And of course, it gets more difficult as we start adding things. But all of it is reactionary. It's all like based on, you know, if you hear somebody play a line or you hear somebody introduce an idea, like maybe you develop that idea, maybe you grab that little thing and you kind of like put your own twist on it and respond to that idea. And you're all trying to do this together. And it still does sound chaotic, but when you're in that situation, you're playing that stuff, you're not just like, oh, I'm just doing my own thing off in my own little world, not listening to anybody else. No, you're taking in the entire environment around you, and it just creates this wall of improvisation. And it's a really cool effect. Nice. Yeah. So we have that sort of that fermata there, and everybody's playing whatever they want all at that same time. And it's really just the peak of that build up to the cutoff, and then we go back into the groove. That's really cool. Back into the melody. I like that. It's again, it's that sort of old school's big band style. I dig that. That's really nice. Whoa. Yeah. Wow. Okay, that's cool. That's a really nice opening. And then of course getting into the two-handed thing, which is really difficult. Any piano players out there, you know exactly what I mean. And that's one of the things that Oscar Peterson, people were just mind blown at his ability to do that. He had just as much ability and dexterity in his left hand as his right hand, which is nuts. I do not. But this is really neat. We got kind of a two-handed thing going on here. Oh! So now he's got two hands going, but they're not playing the same thing anymore, which is even more difficult. And I'm sure a lot of it is part of a melody. So, you know, it's practiced, I'm certain, but it doesn't matter. Like, that's nuts. That's so cool. Boy, I tell you, harmonically, this is very interesting. It's obviously dissonant. You know, there's some slash chords going on. Not super defined harmonically. You're kind of left wondering, where are we? You know, like if you ask me what key this is in, I don't know. Man, the playing is just phenomenal. I mean, really, it's just free improvisation, you know, so I could sit down with a drummer and just kind of like, just start painting ideas and reacting to each other and suggesting new things, and you never know where it's gonna lead you. It's an incredibly fun way to play music because it's just totally blank slate. Nobody has any idea where we are, what's gonna happen, where we're going, but you just kind of work together to navigate and meander through this landscape of sounds and ideas. And that can be some of the most fun music to play. It's interesting because sometimes it's not necessarily the most fun music to listen to until you get players that are at such a high level that they can turn, that they're just in tune with each other so much that they can create incredibly interesting things. And this is kind of reminding me of that. Like, this is incredibly fun to listen to. Wayne Shorter's group with Brian Blade and Danilo Perez, they do a lot of similar stuff where it's a lot of, nobody knows where it's gonna go. And I actually got a chance to talk to Brian about this one time, and he said it was like, they'll take an idea, and the words that he used, which I thought were really interesting, he said, we'll chew on that idea for a little bit and just kind of see what it turns into, and then maybe somebody will suggest a new idea. But it's taking a concept and just looking at it, almost, and just saying, what is this gonna become? And everybody's reacting to each other. I mean, that's what I think is going on here. I could be completely wrong, but what a brilliant duo here. This is fantastic. See, what's cool here is that the drummer's keeping the pulse. You can hear the hi-hat still going on that pulse. If I'm correct about this kind of being more free, what's really fun about a scenario like this is that I don't need to worry about, okay, where are we in the measure? Am I gonna wind up on two and the drummer's gonna wind up on three? Like, are we gonna get separated? It doesn't matter. If you're just kind of taking a pulse but everything else is free, you can let these rhythmic concepts just develop and turn into whatever they're gonna turn into, and you'll meet up at some point. And it doesn't matter where that point is, and then you'll move forward from there. And that's what it sounds like is happening here. I could be completely wrong. All of this could be very much written out ahead of time, which would seem odd, but you know, regardless, it's fantastic. I love it. Wow. Yikes. Oh my God, that's fantastic. The fact that this is the soundtrack of a show, that's so cool to see challenging the viewer's musical capacity. Because I'm sure, you know, everybody watching the show in particular is not necessarily like a fan of this type of music. I mean, not only is this jazz, this is not harmonically typical by any stretch of the imagination. That can be difficult for people to listen to who don't have that experience, who aren't used to hearing things like that. Very cool to see just the unapologetic inclusion of music of this caliber in things like this. That's awesome. Wow, that's phenomenal. Oof. Yeah. This features a trumpet player named Takuya Kuroda. Got some great music out there. Really, really good player. So this is cool to hear. Wow, that's really nice. That's a good example of like a rhythm permutating over the bar line. Keep the thing in 4-4, but keep this rhythm that's not gonna line up with the measure. Just keep it going and let it float its way through the bar in various ways. We did a video about this, actually it's around Periphery, which is like a prog metal band if you're not familiar, and talking about this exact same thing. I'll put a link to that video, and it talks about the usage of a rhythmic figure that doesn't line up with the measure, but yet we just keep starting it over so it moves throughout the bar. It's a really interesting musical device that you can get awesome sounds with. It's extremely just rhythmically interesting. It's fun to listen to. Yeah. Really, really nice. And that's it. That's gonna do it for me. Thank you for your time. Thank you for watching. And we will see you in the next video.